Good morning, everyone. I want to welcome you all to the launch of Humanist International's 2023 Freedom of Thought Report. My name is Nicole Carr, and I'm the Interim Executive Director of the American Humanist Association. It's such a pleasure to have all of you here today for the introduction of this important and timely report. Whether you're here in the United States or joining us from abroad online, before we get started, I would like to express my sincere appreciation to all of you who've taken time out of your hectic schedules to join us for a very special event, including all the many distinguished guests we have in the room with us, including Commissioner Mohammed Majid from the United States Commission on International Religious Freedom, and USERF staff, Representative Jared Huffman of California, and Representative Jamie Raskin of Maryland, who have graciously agreed to participate in today's event. I also want to recognize Representatives Mark Pohan and Steve Cohen, who may be joining us with their staffs later today. Thank you to our partners who are here today from American Atheists, Secular Coalition for America, Freedom from Religion Foundation, as well as our guests from Interfaith Alliance, Freedom House, and the Jubilee Campaign. Most of all, I want to welcome Gary McClelland, Chief Executive of Humanist International, and Humanist International board members Maggie Ardiente and Debbie Goddard. We are so grateful so many of you could attend in person, and a shout out to our virtual audience as well. Today, we gather to celebrate the release of Humanist International's 2023 Freedom of Thought Report. The annual Freedom of Thought Report assesses every country in the world on the basis of human rights and the legal status with regard to humanists, atheists, and the non-religious. It's a unique worldwide survey of persecution and discrimination against humanists, atheists, the non-religious, and religious minorities. Today, we'll be hearing from leaders in the area of freedom of religion and belief, including Dimitrios Panayiotis, who has been persecuted in Greece for his work in human rights and freedom of religion. He'll be joining us later by video. Thank you again to all of you for being with us today. Without further ado, I would like to welcome Congressman Jamie Raskin to the podium. Congressman Raskin, who represents Maryland's 8th District, is a co-chair of the Congressional Freethought Caucus and a champion of freedom of religion and belief. He understands the importance of defending freedom of expression, freedom of thought, and human rights around the world. And he recently announced a sponsorship of Nigerian political prisoner and humanist Mubarak Bala in an effort to urge his pardon. Congressman Raskin.
Nicole, thank you very much. And hello to the American Humanist Association and the people from the Humanist International who are here today. That is awesome. And I want to quickly thank Lily Ballourian and Gary McClelland, and to greet also Ambassador Rashad Hussein and Commissioner Mohammed Majid. So I wish I could be here for the whole thing. I've got to go make a phone call. I'm going to see if I can come back. And thank you for giving me a second just to help kick things off here. I would say that the separation of church and state was the great and revolutionary innovation of the American Constitution. And the thing that we still most have to offer the rest of the world, that is the demonstration of a multi-religious, multicultural, multiracial society that's able to thrive based on the separation of church and state and the freedom of expression and the allied values that are out there. We can see all around the world the way that the theocracies and religiously based political movements are driving the world apart. I know a good joke that tells the story of the exact convergence of religion and tribalism in a lot of places. And I brought it back from Ireland. Jared Huffman knows it already because he knows all my jokes. But this one is the guy is speeding down the street in Belfast, and the cop sees him and turns on the siren, and chases him over to the side of the road, pulls him over, raps on the window, and the guy rolls his window down, and the cop says, "Are you Catholic or are you Protestant?" And the guy says, "I'm an atheist." And the cop says, "Catholic atheist or Protestant atheist?" We're living in a time where religion is used so much as a signifier of tribalism and tribal attachments and as a political weapon. And the framers of our Constitution understood that. Well, we deal with it every day now with the new Speaker of the House. And I got to serve with Mike Johnson, who's a very nice guy and a very polite and civil guy, for 7 years on the Judiciary Committee. But I know the theocratic agenda inside and out. I will not forget the time when they advanced the idea of endorsing the Ten Commandments, because, you know, the Texas legislature had endorsed the Ten Commandments, so we had endorsed the Ten Commandments. And I reminded them of the Establishment Clause. I reminded them of the clause in the Constitution, which says that there shall be no religious tests for public office. None of that moved them. So when they took it to the Rules Committee, I went to the Rules Committee and I introduced a rule with Congressman McGovern saying that if we're going to vote on the Ten Commandments, we should have to vote on each commandment separately. Nobody can get away with that omnibus package. And you can't vote for any commandment that you've ever violated before, because you'd be taking the name of the Lord in vain in violation of the Third Commandment. We've got the opportunity in the House, in Congress, in America, to stand up strong for the separation of church and state against the theocratic agenda and movement that came right into our House on January 6th, 2021 as well. So I'm thrilled about the release of the report. All of the forces of secular, humanist, liberal democracy need to be supporting each other all over the world. I'm thrilled that I've had the opportunity to adopt numerous prisoners of conscience, religious prisoners who are being persecuted, or humanist prisoners who are being persecuted. And this is something that every member of Congress, regardless of party or political ideology, can and should do. And it's something very concrete we can do, even if otherwise we're inhabiting a know-nothing or do-nothing Congress. So I hope I can get back to hang out with you guys later today, but congratulations on the publication of the report and this launch today. And I will see you guys later, I hope.
Thank you very much, Congressman. We hope you will be able to get back to join us. Next to the podium, I'd like to welcome Congressman Jared Huffman. Congressman Huffman, who represents California's 2nd District, identifies as a humanist and is proudly the only openly non-religious member of Congress. Representative Huffman founded the Congressional Freethought Caucus, which he co-chairs with Congressman Raskin, to promote sound public policy based on reason, science, and moral values while protecting the secular character of government and championing the value of freedom of thought worldwide. Please welcome him to the podium.
Well, thank you, Nicole, and hello, everyone. It's great to be with you. It's great to follow my great friend and ally, Jamie Raskin, who is a driving intellectual force of nature and a huge force behind our Congressional Freethought Caucus. The good news, of course, for humanists here is my understanding is you invited all of the humanist members of Congress to attend today, and there's 100% response rate. So that is impressive. Let me also acknowledge that the young man who staffs me so very well on all of these issues, Quentin Dupuy, is here. Just to drive the MAGA theocrats crazy, I have a staffer whose nickname is Q, Quentin. So they will like that. We're here to hear from Humanist International on a very, very important subject. I want to just tell you how much I appreciate this work that you do every single year to assess countries on a rolling cycle based on human rights and legal status of humanists, atheists, other non-religious people, religious minorities as well. It really tells us a lot about the precarious state of secularism in a world that is becoming more secular and ought to better reflect religious diversity and religious freedom. This is coming at a time that's really interesting for those of us that work in these issues, because the Christian nationalist threat did not go away when Donald Trump lost the 2020 election. By the way, he lost the 2020 election. That's news to some people in this Capitol. It is actually more threatening than ever. And if you think about it, in just a few short years, this Christian nationalist movement has stacked the Supreme Court, sacked the U.S. Capitol, taken away women's reproductive choice, and installed a very radical Christian dominionist as the person who's now second in line to the presidency of the United States. And they've been able to do all of this at a time when religiosity in this country is declining, when the actual agenda that they advocate is deeply unpopular across our country. There are a number of reasons for how they've been able to defy political gravity like that, but it is a real threat to our democracy and certainly to the secular character of our republic and to all of the religious freedoms that all of you, I know, care so much about. So this is a very important time to be talking about this subject and hearing from all of you and unveiling this report. You all know my story. I am a humanist like many of you. I rejected the advice I got from everyone around me in 2017 and decided to come out publicly as the only openly non-religious member of Congress. If you spend a little time talking to Jamie Raskin, you will conclude that he is a humanist, but he has not yet publicly embraced that label. We will keep working on it. But I'm the only one crazy enough to publicly come out and do that. I think I'm the only one in history to do it. We had Pete Stark, of course, who was a Unitarian and also publicly acknowledged that he did not believe in a higher power or a supreme being. It's lonely. I will tell you, though, there are a lot more humanists than just me in the Congress, and there are a lot more secularists and non-believers in this country than you see in the United States Congress. Looking around this institution, it's like it was frozen in religious amber from the 1960s or something. You've got pretty dramatic overrepresentation of Protestants, also overrepresentation of Catholics, a lot of overrepresentation of evangelicals in particular. I mean, the nuns, people who don't subscribe to any religion, are a bigger group right now in America than Baptists and Methodists and Catholics and any number of other denominations that people think of as mainstream religious groups. So I think it's important that the secular community in this country feel its power, try to get as organized as possible, and the politics will at some point catch up. It may take a while with the Republicans. They are deeply frozen in religious amber. In fact, their caucus is 99% Christian in a country that is very religiously diverse and certainly does not reflect anything close to those demographics. But we can only keep working and organizing and educating, and that is what all of you do, and I'm just so grateful for it. The biggest, I think, takeaway from those who look at how humanists and atheists and other non-believers are treated around the world is that where they are discriminated against, there's almost 100% correlation of discrimination against other religious minorities. It is a very important red flag that religious freedom is not well when humanists and atheists are being mistreated anywhere in the world. So this report is super important. It should be important to everyone who says they care about religious freedom. But you know, we've got a healthy debate here in the Capitol over what religious freedom even means. You are absolutely champions of religious freedom. And I want to thank you for that, and I want to appreciate it. I talked about the threat of Christian nationalists. Speaker Mike Johnson is someone that I hope all of you will take some time to learn about. This is not some cartoonish threat that we don't need to take seriously. Speaker Johnson has spent his career not just being deeply religious, but trying to impose a very extreme set of biblical codes on the rest of the country and on millions of people who don't agree with him, don't have the same religious views, and certainly don't agree with this radical political agenda that he has been pursuing in the name of religion for his entire career as a lawyer, as a state legislator, and now, you know, we fear as the person who is second in line to the presidency of the United States. So we will be talking more about that, trying to educate members of Congress and staff and the media and other interested parties about just who Speaker Johnson is. We will continue to try to invite him to tell us more about who he is. The Freethought Caucus invited him to have a dialogue with us about these subjects, and he has declined. It was a very nice invitation, too. But we're going to keep extending that invitation, and we're also going to keep inviting all of you and members of Congress and members of the media to ask him the hard questions for which we deserve specific answers. Because this dominionist agenda of his, this Seven Mountains mandate that he is that he subscribes to, is alarming and dangerous and a real threat to both the secular and the democratic character of this country that we love. So thank you for being humanists and for championing the values of science and reason. Speaker Johnson believes that the world was created 6,000 years ago and that people and dinosaurs, you know, ran around together and that there was a great flood and two by two animals went into an ark and all of this literally happened according to, you know, the book of Genesis and so forth. The truth is religion has been in retreat from science and reason for the past couple of thousand years. And there's a reason for that. We know things now. And I will take good old-fashioned post-Enlightenment science and critical thinking and reasoning every single time when it comes to trying to solve the problems of this country and the rest of the world. So thank you for what you do. And good luck with the rest of this gathering. I look forward to hearing more about the report.
Thank you, Congressman Huffman. And thank you for all the wonderful work that you and your staff do for the separation of church and state and for the Freethought Caucus. We truly appreciate it. Next to the podium, we have the pleasure of welcoming United States Ambassador at Large for International Religious Freedom, Rashad Hussein, to the podium. Ambassador Hussein serves as principal advisor to the U.S. Secretary of State and advisor to the U.S. President on religious freedom conditions and policy. He leads the U.S. State Department's efforts to monitor religious freedom abuses, persecution, and discrimination worldwide. He also oversees policies and programs to address these concerns and works to build diverse and dynamic partnerships with the broadest range of civil society with equitable and meaningful inclusion of faith actors globally. Ambassador?
Thank you so much. It's good to be with you this morning. I greatly appreciate your leadership and the work that you do. I wanna thank Nicole Carr and Humanist International for inviting me to the launch of the Humanist International's Freedom of Thought Report. I appreciate the leadership of Greg McKellen, Lily Balorian, and Pagnotte, and others who are at the presentation and are doing this work all around the year. In my role as ambassador for international religious freedom, it's very important to me that we are out there for everyone. And so when we see members of religious communities being persecuted, we speak up and we don't ask questions about, you know, what are the politics behind it and, you know, who's supporting this group and who's not supporting this group. It is our mandate and my obligation that I took the oath of office on to make sure that we are out there speaking up for everyone. And so when we see a sharp rise that we're seeing right now, for example, in anti-Semitism or the spike in Islamophobia, we're out there making sure that we're doing everything that we can. When we see religious minorities being persecuted around the world, we're out there advocating, meeting with governments, meeting with civil society, and making sure that our voices are heard, and very importantly, doing everything that we can to empower our civil society partners. As more than any other area that I've worked on in my career, civil society plays a really leading and critical role in advancing freedom of religion or belief. So it's something that's very important to me. I see it as my obligation under the Constitution as an officer of the United States, and something that's also very personal and important to me. And I will also say that based on my own teaching and upbringing, we have this tradition, this principle that in Arabic is La ikraha fi din, and the imam here will know better than I do, but the meaning of this is that there's no compulsion in religion. You cannot force somebody to adopt a religion. And so it's very important for me to also make sure that we're doing everything when we uphold freedom of religion or belief to make sure that we're clear about the or belief part. And there are, all, as your report notes, people all around the world that are persecuted because they're humanists or atheists or have no particular religious belief. So we wanna make sure that we are doing our obligation to be out there and speaking out when those groups are persecuted as well. I want to express my appreciation and admiration for all the research and all the analysis that went into creating the 2023 report. My work and the work of all who strive to advance freedom of religion or belief and conscience around the globe is better equipped for success because of reports like this. You all know that we have a report that we issue every year through the Office of International Religious Freedom. The Secretary of State rolls out that report every year. We did it earlier this year in the summer. And that report goes literally country by country and highlights religious freedom conditions around the world. And I believe, again, when I said at the beginning that we try to be consistent as possible, if anyone has any questions about our consistency, to please to check out those reports, which are available online. And we go through the status of religious communities and those that don't have any particular religious belief as well. As your report acknowledges, humanists, atheists, and non-religious individuals are facing persecution in many corners of the world. In many countries, public profession of humanist or atheistic belief can result in criminal penalties or even threats to personal safety. The United States takes persecution of individuals because of one's religion or belief very seriously. And as part of our mission, is to promote freedom of religion or belief around the world. Just over 25 years ago, Congress passed the International Religious Freedom Act, which created my position and set forth the vision that the United States is a global leader in securing this fundamental human right. In 2016, Congress elaborated on that commitment with the Frank R. Wolf International Religious Freedom Act, which states that, quote, religious persecution and the specific targeting of non-theists, humanists, and atheists because of their beliefs is often particularly widespread, systematic, and heinous. And that is coming from the International Religious Freedom Act of 2016 from Congressman Frank Wolf, who is on the International Religious Freedom Commission, who we work with closely even now. It also established in law that religious freedom includes a protection of both theistic and non-theistic beliefs, the right not to profess or practice any religion, and protects against, quote, the specific targeting of non-theists, humanists, and atheists because of their beliefs. In some countries, atheism itself is criminalized. Threats to the rights of the non-religious come from a wide range of sources, from individuals and non-state actors to government authorities, and this suppression makes it impossible to be openly or legally non-religious. Oftentimes, individuals who don't have a particular religious faith languish in prison cells, under house arrest, or even in internment camps. Others have simply vanished. One example of this persecution that I want to highlight is the case of Mubarak Bala, known to many of you. Some of you know him personally. We have seen Humanist International fiercely advocate for Mubarak Bala's rights since he was first arrested in 2020 and accused of blasphemy on social media. Today, he sits in a prison in Nigeria, sentenced to 24 years for peacefully expressing his beliefs. Such penalties threaten to silence minority belief groups and further close space for religious pluralism. We are closely tracking his appeal petition and continue to raise the need for for his freedom at the highest levels. True to our own laws and the spirit of Article 18 of the UN Declaration of Human Rights, the United States is firmly committed to freedom of religion or belief, and one that must include all individuals, including the non-religious. And we continue to fight to convince other countries to protect those rights as well. One of the many ways that we do so is by raising awareness of laws criminalizing blasphemy, apostasy, conversion, and proselytization, and the abusive enforcement and violence that such laws encourage. Numerous countries maintain laws criminalizing speech that might defame or insult religious sentiments. Such laws are often used as a pretext to justify vigilantism or mob violence in the name of religion, or as a pretext to pursue personal grievances. One of the first assignments that I had when I came into the State Department earlier in my career was to negotiate a shift away from a resolution at the UN that was known as the Defamation of Religions Resolution. And we believe that that resolution gave sanctions to blasphemy laws. We believe that that resolution made it easier to target religious minorities and political opponents based on what might be considered defamation of religion. And so working with countries around the world, working with the OIC who sponsored the resolution, the Organization for Islamic Cooperation, and literally going country by country and representative by representative at the Human Rights Council in Geneva, we shifted away from the defamation approach, one that also involved the criminalization of speech, to Resolution 1618 and the Istanbul process, which attempts to address the underlying causes of bigotry and discrimination rather than taking this criminalization approach. We also see authorities look the other way when violence is committed. For example, when mobs attack based on an alleged insult. We've seen that in Nigeria. We see governments using laws to wrongfully imprison and punish individuals whose views, including matters of religion or belief, may differ from official narratives or the views of majority populations, including humanists. Freedom of religion or belief and freedom of expression are not in opposition to one another, but rather they are both essential to a robust and a healthy democracy. And with that in mind, I want to applaud an observation made in the report's preface by Andrew Copson. What's at stake in identifying how different countries treat humanists, atheists, and non-religious people is greater than the sum of those individual experiences. At stake are the values of democracy and discourse that unite us and that serve as a foundation for human rights for everyone. Just 2 weeks ago, I was in Prague attending the Ministerial Conference for International Religious Freedom or Belief. The theme for the conference was freedom of religion or belief under authoritarian regimes. Authoritarianism, whether theistic or secular, is a threat to the freedom of all people, regardless of their particular beliefs. The relationship between religious freedom and democracy goes both ways. We know that democratic institutions flourish in societies that are pluralistic, diverse, tolerant, and have an underlying respect for human rights. We know that democracy creates the political and social conditions in which people of varying religions and belief can live together in peace. As President Biden has frequently remarked, the world is at an inflection point. It is at a point in which there is a global contest between autocracy and democracy. The coalition building work that is done by Humanist International and its partners is crucial in this struggle. We must join together across beliefs and religions to unite in defending the rights of every person. Governments and community leaders find it harder to ignore a chorus of voices than a solitary cry for change. The freedom of thought is at stake in that contest, and by doing everything in our power to defend that freedom, I am confident that we will build a freer future together. Thank you so much. Congratulations. I look forward to continuing to work with you to protect the rights of all people around the world, to protect the rights of those who believe, and to protect the rights of those who do not believe. And I think we have a common set of principles to build on that are exemplified in the report that you're issuing today. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Ambassador, and thank you for the very important work that you and your office does on international religious freedom and belief. Next to the podium, we have a representative from the United States Commission on International Religious Freedom, or USIRF, Commissioner Mohammed Majid. Appointed to the United States Commission on International Religious Freedom by U.S. President Joe Biden, Commissioner Majid has focused on promoting freedom of religion or belief, preventing violence against women, and preventing violence and hate in our societies. The commissioner is involved in multiple Islamic and interfaith initiatives that aim to promote peace, pluralism, and the protection of religious minorities. Commissioner?
Good morning. My name is Mohammed Majid, as have been said. I'm a commissioner at U.S. Commission on International Religious Freedom, or USIRF. Thank you very much, Humanist International and American Humanist Association, for inviting me to speak today to mark the release of the very important report on freedom of thought. As you know, USIRF is an independent, bipartisan U.S. federal government body dedicated to promoting universal right to freedom of religion or belief around the world. We defend religious freedom internationally for people of all faith and or none. Throughout the year, USIRF uses international standards to monitor freedom of religion or belief abroad and to make policy recommendation to U.S. government. As the Humanist International report makes clear, Article 18 of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights protects the rights of an individual to reject any religion or belief, to identify as a humanist or atheist, and to manifest non-religious conviction through expressions, teaching, and practice. Despite this sweeping protections, the right to freedom of religion or belief of the non-religious is frequently overlooked. And very disturbingly, Humanist International found that the majority of countries around the world fail to protect the rights of humanists, atheists, and non-religious. USIRF is also closely monitoring and report violation committed against non-religious population. I will offer just a few brief observations based on our reporting. Government continue to use blasphemy law to target non-religious for punishment, including fines, imprisonment, death penalty. In September, USIRF released a report showing that 95 countries around the world have national level laws criminalizing blasphemy. The prevalence of blasphemy laws globally is concerning, given their clear inconsistency with international human rights law protections for both the right to freedom of religion or belief and the right to freedom of opinion and expressions. We have also been tracking cases of non-religious individuals who have been detained and imprisoned based on blasphemy allegation through our Frank Wolf Freedom of Religion or Belief Victim List. I don't know if you're familiar with that. Congress requires USIRF to maintain the victim list, which contain profiles of certain victims of religious persecution, including humanists. I encourage you all to consult to the victim of the list, the victim list. And if you know of any humanist or non-religious individuals who have been targeted or persecuted, I invite you to log into USIRF website and submit information for us to review. We'll welcome all of your participation so that we can become aware of those who've been persecuted around the world. In addition, the blasphemy laws, USIRF closely monitor legislation that criminalize or impose legal burden on individuals' freedom to convert from one religion or belief to another, or to non-belief at all, otherwise known as anti-conversion laws. Just a few weeks ago, we released a report showing 73 national level laws limiting the freedom to convert, including seven criminalization apostasy are in force across 46 countries around the world. Apostasy laws are particularly creating problems for humanist and other non-religious individuals because they harshly punish renunciation of one religion or belief. It is not uncommon for apostasy laws to maintain, to mandate death penalty. In addition, Yusuf reporting indicate that over the last several years, state governments in India have implemented restriction on conversion. Currently, 13 states have laws prohibiting or limiting an individual's ability to convert or change the religion. These laws use vague language and come with hefty fines and punishments. Finally, Yusuf recently released a report on religious grab and international human rights law. Our analysis shows that laws in countries such as Afghanistan, Iran, that forces individuals to wear religious clothing, regardless of whether they are religious or not, and often come with criminal penalties. These laws are deeply inconsistent with the international human rights laws and violate individuals' freedom to manifest their belief or non-belief in accordance with their conscience. Before I conclude, I want to say I'm an imam. I don't know if you know that. you can see my hat. I want to say that it's very disturbing to me as a clergy that Islam or my religion we use to restrict people's choice of believe or not to believe. There's nothing in my own religion that says that. For I stand with you for freedom for all, that we need to protect the public square and to make sure no one being persecuted because chose not to believe. And blasphemy law, use of blasphemy law, is very disturbing to me that we cannot force people to believe. And as the ambassador have said, that there's a verse in the Quran says no compulsion religion. I want to say that because I think it's important, because I'm disturbed by seeing many blasphemy laws, especially in Muslim countries, being used to persecute people who choose not to believe or to convert or to change their religion. Thank you again for inviting me to speak today. We as Yusuf, we're grateful for the work you do and look forward to learning from your new reports and to see how can we work with you, incorporate some of your findings to our reports. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Commissioner, both for your words and for the very important work you do with the Commission. Before Gary McClellan comes up to present the report, I would like to introduce the American Humanist Association's legal and policy director, Lily Balorian. The proud daughter of Iranian asylees, Lily is a seasoned strategist, policy wonk, and advocate with over 15 years of experience working to promote secular democracy and progressive values.
Hello, everyone. Well, what a few tough acts to follow. So my name is Lily Balorian, and I am the legal and policy director of the American Humanist Association, as Nicole just said. But first, on behalf of the AHA, I just want to thank all of you again for being here today, with a special shout out to our special esteemed guests who took their time to speak with us today. So I want to speak in my remarks today about some of the threats we face here in the United States related to religious fundamentalism and Christian nationalism. But I'd first like to share where I come from and why this work is so personal to me. I am the proud daughter of two Iranians who traveled to the United States in their early 20s for an education, two people filled with hopes and dreams with the full intention of returning to Iran. Instead, my parents became asylees overnight as the nation that they grew up in devolved into an unrecognizable theocracy. My parents made the impossible choice that so many other asylum seekers and refugees have to make every single day. Leave everyone and everything you know behind, or raise your future family under authoritarianism and gender apartheid. For me and for my sister, although we were just a twinkle in their eye, they chose the former. Iran, under the regime that currently occupies it illegitimately, is perhaps the best example of what happens when we allow religious fundamentalists with anti-pluralistic agendas to embed themselves within governments. We do not need to use our imagination or conceive of the fictional land of Gilead to imagine a dystopian theocracy. We only need to look at how women and religious and ethnic minorities are treated under the so-called Islamic Republic of Iran, a nation that has very much earned its dark red grave violations rating from Humanist International when it comes to freedom of religion, thought, and belief. I know all of you saw, and many of you rose with us, when Iranians took to the streets last year demanding regime change after the murder of Jina Mahsa Amini. Pardon me, I get emotional about this. A 22-year-old Kurdish-Iranian woman who was killed by the morality police in Iran for allegedly improperly wearing the state-mandated hijab. The protests, led largely by young women, had a simple message. Woman, life, freedom. Zan, Zindagi Azadi. But these peaceful protests were responded to brutally by the regime, with ethnic and religious minorities being disproportionately targeted. Hundreds of protests were killed, including many children and teens. There were over 10,000 arrested, imprisoned, and tortured, many sentenced to death, and 8 innocent men were officially executed for their participation in protests calling for freedom for the women of Iran. Within Iranian prisons are many prisoners of conscience, including 2023 Nobel laureate Narges Mohammadi, who was given her award for her long-standing fight against the oppression of women in Iran and to promote human rights and freedom for all within that country. But she was unable to travel to receive her award because she remains a political prisoner locked up in Iran. And while the government of Iran is certainly unique in many ways, it is incumbent upon all of us who live in countries with the ostensible right to freedom of speech and expression to remain vigilant of the ways in which similar forces are working to turn our nations into their own flavor of theocracy. Please remember that Iran or Persia is an ancient civilization with thousands of years of invaluable contributions to the world, to the world's understanding of math, poetry, arts, and yes, human rights. The horrors we see today from that nation came after a largely liberal society slipped very quickly into theocracy in 1979 during the chaos of revolution. And look at what has happened to its people over the last nearly 5 decades. We must understand that the U.S. is not immune to the types of repression we see highlighted in this report. We must stop allowing ourselves to believe American exceptionalism will protect church-state separation or stop Christian nationalism from decimating the shared values we all hold so dear. There is no legitimate question about whether or not the U.S. is and was intended to be a secular nation, because our Constitution makes it extremely clear. Indeed, the very first line of the First Amendment reads, "Congress shall make no law respecting an establishment of religion or prohibiting the free exercise thereof." Crystal clear to me. And so the United States has always claimed to be this bastion of freedom and civil liberties, an example to the world, a city upon a hill because of our outsized role in global affairs. But because of this, the U.S. also has a solemn responsibility to ensure our secular and pluralistic principles remain strongly protected at home. But these very principles that make the U.S. great are in danger. Indeed, in the United States, we're watching as religious fundamentalists and Christian nationalists are fighting to take hold of all of our institutions and redefine American democracy. From the courts, to Congress, to public schools and more, the attacks on the secular fiber of our democracy are increasing and coordinated. Just 2 years ago, a violent Christian nationalist insurrection took place right next door in the U.S. Capitol building with the intent of thwarting our secular democracy by any means necessary. At the AHA, we work diligently every day to monitor and respond to these threats, to ensure that the United States adheres to its secular ideals and champions true religious freedom across the world. Our work is cut out for us, and it will take all of our collective efforts to thwart threats to secular democracy and our goal of a truly equitable society. We each have a critical role in ensuring that freedom of religion and belief is more than just an aspirational goal, but a daily lived reality in all of our communities. There is so much on the line if we let religious fundamentalism take over our government. We've already seen access to abortion be decimated and contraception, LGBTQ rights and liberation, the ability of non-white, non-Christian people to immigrate or seek asylum to the U.S., and the very future of the sustainability of our planet. As humanists, we're of the radical belief that a better, more equitable, more ethical, more just world is possible. We believe in truth, reason, and progress, and are committed to creating a pluralistic society where non-believers and believers of all faiths are protected, uplifted, and able to freely exercise and express their beliefs without fear of repression. Together, all of us in this room, we have the power to hold that critical line that separates religion from government. And it is an honor to build with all of you towards that brighter future. I do believe that we will win, and I'm grateful for your time. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Lily, for that very powerful expression of the importance of this report. Now it is my honor to introduce Gary McClelland of Humanists International. Gary has served as the chief executive of Humanists International since 2017. Today, he will be presenting the findings of the 2023 Freedom of Thought Report.
Good morning, everybody, esteemed guests and friends. And I want to say hello, especially to all of our colleagues around the world who are joining us and watching these proceedings online. I was advised by a local friend since I've been in town that I have something called an accent, apparently. So I will try and speak slowly and clearly, and I hope that you can understand what I'm saying. I'm very deeply honored to be joined by the individuals dedicated to this most important cause of the freedom of thought today. Lily Balourian, Panayoti Dimitras, my friend who you'll hear from very shortly, representatives Jared Huffman and Jamie Raskin, of course, the ambassador and Commissioner Majid. It's a great honor. And I think for those of us in this movement, I think it's maybe just a moment to stand back and reflect on how important it is to have such good friends in this cause of freedom of religion or belief. I also want to make, if I can, another important reference to one of my colleagues, Emma Wadsworth-Jones. Emma is the editor of this report. She coordinates all of the research volunteers, all of our members and associates around the world who are able to input to this very substantial report. Copies of which I think are now available at the back for those of you who are here in person. And I really just would like to ask if you people who are in the room would join me in a short token of appreciation to the excellent hard work that Emma does to produce this report every year. Yeah, I don't know if you can see that, Emma, but there's a room full of people clapping for you. Very appreciative. So we gather here today to launch the 2023 edition of the Freedom of Thought Report. The report is now in its 12th year. It scrutinizes the legal and human rights landscape for humanists, atheists, and non-religious people across the globe. Its findings compel us to reflect on the challenges at hand, and more importantly, to consider what actionable steps we can take together to build positive change. And I will have some suggestions for you all very shortly. Before we unpack the insightful analysis inside this year's report, allow me just briefly to outline the broader mission of Humanists International. For 7 decades now, Humanists International has been at the forefront of championing human rights, secularism, freedom of religion or belief for all on the global scale. With an unwavering commitment to defending human rights of atheists and the non-religious, Humanists International has become a powerful force for change through extensive research, advocacy, collaborative efforts with like-minded organizations, many of whom are here today, we strive to create a world where every individual can freely believe and express their beliefs without fear of discrimination or persecution. We ourselves are at the heart of a global network of 130 organizations that strive to do this all around the world, many of whom I know are watching today from all around the world. I think the Freedom of Thought report really stands as a testament to our ongoing commitment to shed light on the challenges faced by non-religious individuals and mobilizing collective action for inclusive change on this important agenda. Moving on to some of the contents of the report, our examination reveals a very disturbing reality where humanists face discrimination in 186 countries around the world. For those of you that are doing the maths, that's quite a lot. Depending on how you count them, almost all. This discrimination takes various forms, ranging from overt marginalization, violence, legal prohibitions against identifying as atheist or non-religious. It's crucial to dissect this nuanced aspect of this discrimination so that we can craft effective strategies for progress. In 11 countries, government figures or state agencies openly marginalize, harass, or incite violence against the non-religious. In 15 countries, it is illegal or unrecognized to identify as an atheist or a non-religious person, infringing upon the fundamental right to express one's beliefs. The report uncovers instances where a state religion limits the rights of those who do not adhere to the prescribed belief system. In 23 countries, non-religious individuals are barred from holding certain public offices, impeding their full participation in civic life. Moreover, as has been mentioned by our distinguished guests, blasphemy remains a punishable offence in at least 87 countries, perpetrating the outdated and regressive norms associated with that practice. Religious courts influencing family or moral matters in 48 countries raise concerns about the separation of religion and state. Discriminatory funding of religion in 85 countries exacerbates inequality, while 32 countries make it difficult or illegal to run overtly humanist organizations. Mandatory religious instruction in state-funded schools without a secular or humanist alternative exists in 33 countries around the world, highlighting the need for inclusive educational environments. The key countries edition of this report, which is the one which is available for you today, the key countries edition of this report underscores the global nature of this challenge. It examines countries with different forms of governments, ranging from democracies to absolute monarchies and theocracies. The inclusion of countries includes Australia, Brunei, Burkina Faso, Canada, the Czech Republic, Iran, North Macedonia, Russia, Slovakia, and Zambia. And it reveals the widespread nature of the issues which confront us. So, what actionable steps can we take to address this global challenge? I'm going to address some of my points, I think, to our partners that are in this room and also generally to the US government, since we're here and we have the opportunity. The first one I want to say is that we have an opportunity through our own diplomatic advocacy opportunities as NGOs, but also obviously with the weight of the US government. We feel that we should really leverage the opportunity of US foreign policy and diplomatic advocacy to make sure that freedom of religion or belief for all, a genuine and inclusive freedom of religion or belief for all, is one of the many important human rights factors that is taken into consideration in foreign policy interactions. It's very important, I think, has been touched upon earlier, when we talk about freedom of religion or belief, and I think that terminology is very important, we have to avoid an idea of an exceptionalist form of religious freedom. When we talk about freedom of religion or belief for all, we need the balancing of rights of every individual to freely express their genuinely held beliefs. And we need to avoid this idea that religious freedom somehow trumps other human rights. We have to make sure that we're moving forward in an integrated, balanced way with all human rights, of which freedom of religion or belief is an important one. Foreign aid conditions is another issue I want to mention. It's become common in recent years for foreign aid to be directed through religious organizations on the ground in many countries. And we have to be very careful with this. As has been mentioned by the ambassador and others, we know that in many countries, minority religious beliefs and non-religious beliefs are very often at the whim of majoritarian belief systems. This is exemplified in blasphemy laws and other coercive control approaches. So we need to be very careful that, especially with foreign aid, when we're partnering with religious organizations or majoritarian religious organizations, we need to make sure they're aware of their responsibility to be engaging with all faith and belief communities, and that includes non-religious people. I can tell you confidently that I know of non-religious communities that exist in almost every country in the world. So those people are there, they do exist. In many countries, even meeting up, existing, even choosing to identify themselves is an act of such defiance that it can often put their life in danger. So they may not be visible, but I can tell you that they are there. International partnerships are really important. Being here with our colleagues from AHA, American Atheists, Secular Coalition for America, and others, it's really important that we maintain and strengthen these international partnerships. And the other thing I want to say is, as has been mentioned by the ambassador before, this is something on which we should all agree, religious, non-religious, it shouldn't matter. We should be in favor of freedom of religion and belief for all. And I want to make it clear that if opportunities exist for Humanists International to partner with religious organizations and religious partners in the future, we welcome that. You know, we would like to make this something which is a genuine open call for international partnerships. Support for at-risk individuals. I know there's some colleagues, again, here today that are doing that important work. And this, as the ambassador mentioned, the case of Mubarak Bala, being able to provide this support for individuals who are human rights defenders, who are speaking out, who are at the coalface of this important work that we do is absolutely imperative. The promotion of, I think, something very close to the heart of American culture, secular governance, the separation of religion and state, should be something, a principle, I think, which underlines all of the work that we do to promote freedom of religion or belief for all. And I think that's something, again, which should be very close to the heart of US foreign policy. And the last thing I want to say is educational initiatives. So again, with some of the partners in this room, Humanists International has been very privileged to work with a number of organizations providing inclusive education opportunities, training opportunities about the important fundamental right of freedom of religion or belief for all. And we welcome that. And we look very much forward to what opportunities there might be in the future to strengthen that work. So in conclusion, I think we really stand here at the intersection of a challenge and an opportunity. We should be drawing inspiration from the rich tapestry of human resilience and the enduring memory of those who have dared to question dogmas. The Freedom of Thought report not only serves as a mirror reflecting the injustices faced by many, but it also beckons us to be the architects of change. It's a rallying cry for governments, civil society, CSOs, and individuals to unite in a shared commitment to dismantle the barriers that that stifle freedom of thought, conscience, religion, or belief around the world. We must forge new partnerships and strengthen existing alliances to make sure we can do this important work. And together, as partners and allies, we can usher in an era where the freedom of thought flame burns brightly for all. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. As Gary mentioned, there are copies of the report. And do you have the, do you know the URL if people want to? FOT.humanists.international to access the report online. Lastly, we have some remarks in video format from Panayote Dimitras, human rights defender and Humanist International case of concern, who wrote actually the foreword to this report. Dimitras faces judicial harassment, threats of violence, and smear campaigns in Greece as in an apparent attempt to prevent his work to defend humanist rights in that country. Humanist International fears that Dimitras is being subjected to such antagonism in retaliation for his peaceful exercise of his rights to freedom of expression. Stories like Dimitras's prove the need and importance of monitoring freedom of religion or belief of humanists, atheists, and the non-religious. And an example, unfortunately, of the persecution that he faces. We had hoped that he would be with us here today. He is not, because he's been banned from traveling by the Greek government. So he's going to show his uh, He's going to share his story with us on video. Emily?
Colleagues, esteemed guests, and advocates for freedom and human rights. Thank you for gathering here today at the launch of the 2023 Freedom of Thought Report. It is both an honor and a privilege to stand before you, sharing my journey as a human rights defender and a proponent of humanist values in Greece. My name is Panagiotis Dimitras, and I co-founded the Greekly Thinking Monitor and Minority Rights Group Greece 3 decades ago, along with the Humanist Union of Greece in 2010. Our journey as humanists and defenders of human rights has been fraught with challenges and obstacles. In the pursuit of justice and equality, I faced intense harassment and discrimination from the authorities. There was particularly evidence in the defense of ethnic minorities, a cause that led to my expulsion from State University where I taught. My book, Addressing the Rights of Minorities, was banned, and my right to attend international conferences was denied in a blatant violation of academic freedom. In 1993, we conducted a fact-finding mission alongside Human Rights Watch and the Danish Helsinki Committee to investigate the challenges faced by the Macedonian minority in Greece. The consequences were severe. A detailed report by the Secret Service, including personal information of those involved in the mission, was published by an extreme-right neo-Nazi group. Despite the backlash, our NGO reports brought the Macedonian minority into national and international focus, challenging the government's refusal to acknowledge its existence. The struggle continued over the years, with criminal investigations and legal battles aimed at suppressing our work. In 2015, the European Court of Human Rights ruled that Greece had violated the freedom of association of a Macedonian minority association, reinforcing the need for vigilance in protecting the rights of marginalized communities. Since 2015, the Greek Helsinki Monitor has documented numerous cases of hate speech, hate crimes, and violent pushbacks against asylum seekers. Despite facing charges of filing false complaints, we persisted in our commitment to justice. The legal challenges culminated in a recent case where I was accused of forming a criminal organization for reporting the arrivals of asylum seekers, a clear attempt to undermine our efforts in promoting and defending human rights. This year, my personal and professional life has been marred by restrictive measures, a travel ban, and the freezing of a bank account, all orchestrated to pressure me into abandoning my work. This pattern of behavior by the Greek authorities has not gone unnoticed, as it has been condemned by the UN Special Rapporteur on Human Rights Defenders and the Council of Europe Human Rights Commissioner. Amidst these challenges, I want to highlight some positive developments. Legal victories against Greece in 2010-2012 led to the amendment in the law abolishing the mandatory religious oath in criminal proceedings. Additionally, the extension of civil partnerships to same-sex couples in 2015 marked a triumph for humanist values. As we navigate the complexities for advocating for human rights, we must recognize the pivotal role that democracy plays in safeguarding these principles. Democracy serves as a bedrock for humanists, providing a platform for dialogue, inclusivity, and protection of minority rights. The journey may be arduous, but it is through the collective efforts of organizations like ours that positive change is achieved. In conclusion, I stand before you as a testament to the resilience of the human spirit in the face of adversity. The struggles we endure are not in vain, and the pursuit of justice and human rights is a noble cause for fighting for. As we launch the 2023 Freedom of Thought Report, let us renew our commitment to defending the rights of all individuals, irrespective of their background or beliefs. Thank you.
Now we're going to open the floor for questions.
From one of our online attendees, from John, he says, I am impressed by the map rankings of Mongolia in the report. How objectively based is their assessment?
That's a Gary question.
Thank you for that question, that very detailed question, John. I'm probably not armed at the moment to give you a very detailed response to that, but I'm happy to get back to you. If the report, which is available today, is a summary copy of the online report. So all the data that powers the findings of the report is published as an open source data through a Creative Commons license. So if you go into the website, which is fot.humanists.international, you can navigate to a page which is for each country in the world. And in that page, you will find a link to the open source data where you can analyze every single piece of data that we've collected to power the ratings of that report. So I think that's probably as detailed as I can get at this stage, but I will certainly follow up with you, John, afterwards, and we see if we can get a more detailed answer. Thank you.
Do we have any questions from anyone in the room? Scott? Wait for the mic so they can hear you online.
Question for Gary. In your remarks, you mentioned Canada. Could you just tell us what they've done or not done to deserve a mention?
So every year we pick a selection of countries to be in our Key Countries Edition, which is this short summary document, which is published here. There's a variety of reasons we choose the countries we do. It may be that their UPR submission is up for renewal soon so that we have a more accurate picture of their data. It may be that we think that they are emblematic of a trend or another reason to be focused on for a particular reason. I'm not sure exactly the reason why Canada was included in the report this year, but usually it's just to pick out a selection of countries which have either improved or, you know, show cause for concern, or are just simply, a selection of countries which we think are part of the rolling five-year process of updates. So there won't be any specific reason that Canada was included other than to serve as a selection of the countries updated this year.
Anything else?
Chen.
Okay.
It's from an anonymous attendee. Can you share any best practices about how to use the report to help promote tolerance?
Just let you stay there.
That's a great question. I mean, I think, first of all, having access to this data can be a really important tool for meetings that you might have with political representatives, other NGOs. I mean, I know from meeting with many of the people in this room today that being able to have at your fingertips a well-resourced set of information is really helpful for trying to make to draw attention to particular causes for concern and cases and so on. Again, on the Humanist International website, you will also find, for example, cases of concern. So a bit like USARF's political prisoners list, we have a list of cases of concern on our website, which is cases that we're either working on from a casework point of view or an advocacy point of view. And again, these can be useful ways of trying to demonstrate to policymakers the challenges that face humanists around the world. So I think get a copy of the report and make sure that you speak to your local representatives. If you're from an organization, you're probably already engaged to some extent with your political representatives. But if you're not doing that, then I would strongly encourage you to do so. You know, make sure you email your representatives, make sure you send them copies of the report, make sure that you yourself identify yourself, if indeed you belong to the community, as a member, to make sure that, you know, the voice of humanists is heard in these meetings and discussions. So I think you just get the word out there, speak to people, share the report online, send copies to people, just get the information out there as much as you can, I think is the best advice.
Oh, yes.
Thank you. Holga with Jubilee Campaign and Set My People Free. I first of all want to say thank you to American Humanist Association because they've done a lot of work on passing HRS 512 and actually led the civil society coalition, which was multi-faith and multi-belief. So I was wondering what the impact of the passing of the resolution has had. And also, also efforts to repeal the death penalty for apostasy and blasphemy, if there's been any steps on that, and if the Humanist International is what advocacy is being done at the UN looking forward on apostasy and blasphemy laws, especially also with what happened in March with the pressure on following Quran burnings and so on, if there's some efforts in the UN. And so in the final, we were so happy with Denmark repealed their blasphemy law. So what is the response with now they're banning the burning of religious books? Yeah, those were the two questions, three comments.
I'm sorry, can you tell me what, I don't know the resolutions by their numbers. Can you?
HRS 512 is calling for the global repeal of apostasy and blasphemy laws. Yes, and you were key on that.
Thank you. I don't actually have much information on how that has progressed since then. I know we have lots of knowledge in the room. Does anybody else know more than me? I'm sorry. I can check on that and get back to you. But and maybe you have more information. Well, it's certainly disappointing that Denmark has passed new laws against burning religious books, for instance. And Gary, maybe you have more to say about that.
Yeah, I mean, on the issue of blasphemy laws, we actually run the End Blasphemy Laws campaign, which, if you Google it, you will find it. I think the website is end-blasphemy-laws.org, and that website maintains a list of up-to-date countries with blasphemy laws and details on when, you know, when they're repealed and when they're not, et cetera, et cetera. And yes, I mean, the ending blasphemy laws is a key part of our international advocacy efforts. So, you know, where it's ever appropriate to do so, we will strongly make that case. And of course, in all of our reportage, it's very much a key part of something that we draw attention to. And I think as well, one of those issues which we should be making common cause with everybody, you know, across the world, with all the NGOs, civil society groups, and all religion and beliefs. On the issue of Denmark, yes, it's an interesting one. I know that, in fact, a lot of us who are here in this room today were in Denmark in Copenhagen just a few months ago for the World Humanist Congress, where we were hosted by a coalition of Nordic humanist organizations. In fact, there's probably some people on this call from the Nordic or indeed the Danish organization. I don't know if there's some way in which they can reach out to us and tell us what's happening in the chat comments or something. But I know that they are very much active on this issue, and they're following the passage of the book burning bill and are very much you know, a lot alert to it. I'm not sure exactly what the current status is of that, but I know it's something which is very much on their radar, and we're in discussions with the Danish humanists about that and what their response is. So there might be some bubble pop up with information from the Danish humanists, I'm not sure, but yeah. Clearly, I think the repeal of blasphemy laws worldwide is something which should unite every single person in this room and also every right-thinking person in the world, I would imagine. So, yeah.
We have another online question, and they're wondering whether or not the report is officially sent to each country's government head, and what important feedback have you received from previous reports?
I can tell you one thing that staff at from USERF told us today, that they do use the report and that it's an important help to them in their work. So that's one piece of information. Gary can give you more.
So Humanist International, as I said before, is at the heart of this global network. And what we do is we send out information packs and, Emma sends out information packs and guidance to help our members host launch events. So this launch event in Washington is being hosted by the American Humanist Association. There will be other launch events held in capitals all around the world by local and national humanist organizations. And we very much encourage them to do so, to send it to representatives, heads of governments, freedom of religion and belief ambassadors, and so on. And you know, we try to provide as many tools and support to organizations to do that as possible. One thing we've been trialing this year is to make sort of country-specific versions of the report. So if you're in you know, the UK, and you want to get a UK-specific version of the report, which focuses obviously on the UK, to send to the government. We're trying to find ways to make that happen, to make it a bit more of a useful advocacy tool locally. So yeah, absolutely encourage people to send it to their governments and other NGOs and get everybody involved in the process. It's obviously not necessarily our place as the international organization to lead those efforts. In terms of the impact of the report, we do gather information on the impact of the report every year. And as Nicole has just said, we get some really, really positive feedback from policymakers. And we've had some really amazing testimonials from UN officials, including former Freedom of Religion or Belief special rapporteurs, about the usefulness of this report. Having, you know, every single reference that we have in the report is listed. As I said before, all of the data and the analysis and the calculations is published online. We're very open to receiving feedback and criticism if anybody has any. You know, we're trying to come at this in a very humble way to kind of show all of the information that sits behind the report. And yeah, I think we've had a really impressive and strong feedback from people that this is a tool which is very helpful for them.
We've also had a few online questions about the trends that you see in comparing this year's report to the past year's reports.
So I think the trends that we see at the moment are, well, we've seen in many countries, and I think the United States would be one, a strengthening of the Alliance for Freedom of Religion or Belief for an inclusive approach, which is inclusive of atheists and non-religious people. The Alliance and the partners that we've been building have been growing and strengthening, and I think it's testament to the panel that AHA has put on today to see that embodied. So that is obviously a very positive development. We've seen in other parts of the world, though, that the trends, the populist anti-minority trends that are facing every minority community are, of course, also directed at humanists and the non-religious. So we know that, I think the ambassador said it himself earlier, that, or maybe I think it was Congressman Huffman, where atheists and humanists are persecuted, you can be sure that other minority groups will also be getting persecuted. And that's because of the intersectional nature of all human rights. And I think, as is the, you know, been clearly evidenced with other minority experiences, the same is true for atheists and humanists. So it is a grim situation. I think we are trying to upskill ourselves and our tools and our alliances to try and push back against it. But yes, it is. It does make for very grim reading. And atheists and humanists are a very easy scapegoat for many populist religious leaders to rail against, perhaps even in this country. So yeah, grim reading.
I do think there's often from people in the United States some surprise that we rate as well as we do in the report, but in comparison to other countries, obviously, we do rate better. Nick?
Hi, I'm Nick Fish, president of American Atheists. I wonder if Gary could just run through for folks who might be watching and for folks in the room, the goal of Humanist International and the work that you do and the sort of mission of this report and the distinction that you might draw between promoting humanism, promoting atheism, promoting non-religion versus viewing this as a freedom of religion or belief issue specifically on this report and how you kind of tease that out, because I know that a lot of your member organizations across the world, many of them have an explicit, you know, mandate to advocate for humanism or advocate for atheism, and how you distinguish between what the member groups do and what you all do as an international group and the role this report plays in that. I think that might be helpful for people.
Yeah, thanks, Nick. I think for us, this report is really meant to be a very encyclopedic analysis of the current situation. And as Nicole sort of mentioned there, we focus very much on law and policy. This is a hard letter desk report. So we're very much looking at the analysis of law and policy as it relates to the human rights, particularly of humanist, atheists, and the non-religious. But because of our commitment through our humanist values to freedom of religion and belief, which is inclusive of all, We also know that many of the findings in our report will be applicable to all minority belief groups. It just so happens that we happen to come with a particular expertise and focus on the rights of humanists, atheists, and the non-religious. So for us, it's very important that that is an open, inclusive, and transparent process. And that's why we go to very great lengths to make all of the data underneath this report available for public scrutiny. And I think it is often that case of almost having, as part of this wider network, a dual mission. You know, we exist obviously to some extent in some of our community building work to promote our values and beliefs and to to celebrate them. But on the other hand, we also want to build a world which isn't just simply a reflection of our particular group beliefs, but is also one in which is welcoming and tolerant to all beliefs. You know, we have a genuine commitment to an open, pluralist, tolerant society. We don't want a humanist or an atheist world. We want one which is open and free for everybody to express and embody their beliefs. And I think that's, I think, the important distinction to make through this work.
Unless there are any other questions, that I think that was actually a nice place to end. Oh,
hi. Yes. I actually will just address Huldo's question from before. But the previous policy director at AHA actually, yeah, she did help spearhead the HRES 512, the apostasy and blasphemy resolution. If I'm not mistaken, she also worked with like secular and groups of faith to get that move forward. Resolutions in Congress are definitely important in garnering attention, building off of them. They can be instrumental, as we see, for example, from Congressman Raskin's sponsorship of the law. But other things have happened like governmentally too, so such as the, I believe that their name, somebody can correct me, IRFBA, the International Freedom Belief Alliance, actually just a few weeks ago put out a statement. Their chair put out a statement about Murag Bala, for example. So apostasy and blasphemy efforts in Congress would certainly remain an interest of ours as well. So thank you.
Thank you, Isabella. In closing, I just want to thank everybody for joining us for the release of this crucial report. I want to thank especially the staffs of USERF and congressional staff who joined us, and the speakers, Ambassador at Large for International Religious Freedom, Rashad Hussein, and USERF Commissioner Mohammed Majid, and certainly Gary McClellan for joining us from all the way from Scotland. So.